This is your girl, Yannick Taylor, a.k.a. Priestess, hostess of Conversations with the Priestess. Here's a preview of what you may hear on Conversations with the Priestess.
We weren't meant for monogamy, let's be honest. Like, we have needs, let's be real. And communicating that, what you want, what you don't want, what sets up...
Now, this drink is brown, because I learned something. Since I'm older, I can't do brown liquor anymore. Also, I noticed since I started on hormone replacement therapy, HRT, in 2015, me and certain liquors don't mix well. I don't know whether...
And I recognize that a lot of men love to be dominated by women. And that's because men are seen as these leaders, as this big alpha male dominant thing, dominant being. And because they're put on this pedestal of being leaders, sometimes they want to be submissive.
Back when I cosplayed a butch queen in South Carolina around 2011, I was on Craigslist. This is when Craigslist was bumping and before they had gotten rid of the personal section.
I hope you enjoyed that preview. Join me on Wednesdays at 9 p.m. for Priestess After Dark. Full video versions of the podcast can be found on patreon.com/CWTPriestess. And join me on Fridays at noon for our regular Friday post. Live, love, and be free. Smooches.
Available on Spotify, Apple Podcasts, YouTube, anywhere you download and stream podcasts.
Brit Picks!
Hello there, it's me, Jimmy Stewart.
How'd you get back in here?
Listen, I thought I had a touch of class for this podcast. I heard you had some chaps from overseas, and they sounded a bit dastardly.
Yeah, they weren't nice, but like we had them cleared out at that point. You know, I mean, we were ready to do our podcast, and now we got you kind of coming in, and We're not ungrateful. We're happy you came by, Mr. Stewart. We appreciate every old dead star that comes by and says something to us, but you're kind of getting in the way at this point.
Now, let me tell you something, boys. Now, if there's anything Jimmy Stewart knows, it's British film.
I'm sure you did. I'm sure you flew over Britain quite a few times and happened to catch a few reels from the window of your airplane.
That's right. I thought I wrote a bit of a poem for you.
You're starting to sound a little bit like Nicolas Cage there, Mr. Stewart.
I don't know who that is.
Oh, okay.
Could I read my poem?
All right, Mr. Stewart, if you would like.
Okay. A podcast about British film. They talked about A Taste of Honey. It's not a movie in which I spent money. What about my old dog, Spot? My old dog Spot, whose corpse is starting to rot. My dog Spot was a great dog. My dog Spot would sleep like a log.
Okay.
This is a first draft.
Yeah.
I'm almost done.
I'm becoming more and more convinced that you're Nicolas Cage pretending to be Jimmy Stewart.
I'm almost done, okay?
Okay, continue.
Okay. Brendan and Jason talking and crying.
Okay.
But let me tell you something. This is a great show, and I ain't lying. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Stewart. General Stewart, thank you.
And now for screen and country.
Wow, he really worked at that one.
Oh, hey, Jason, sorry I was late. Did I miss anything?
No. Everything was just fine.
Are you just sitting here waiting for me?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, let's just move on.
Okay, well, that sounds good to me. This is a podcast.
Brit Picks!
Yep.
I mean, yes. This is a podcast about British film.
It is a podcast. Hosted by... Yeah.
You, Brendan.
Yes, that's me. And you,
Jason.
That's you.
That's me. And with this podcast, we talk about British film.
of a British nature.
From British people.
On the British Film Institute Top 100 British Films of All Time list. But not this week.
No.
This is our final part of our little mini-series.
Brit Picks!
You might have guessed it was called Brit Picks.
Brit Picks!
So, of course, we started out with Sexy Beast. Yep. We did Happy Go Lucky.
Mm-hmm.
We did Scrooge just before the Christmas break. We're back. It's 2020. Very excited.
Woo! Happy New Year, everybody. It's going to be the worst year ever.
Oh, wow. Jason, everything.
That's also a podcast, The Worst Year Ever. Check it out. Very
okay,
funny guys.
Jason, they don't need that.
Yes, they do.
They'll be fine.
I'm just hoping they'll mention us. Please, guys, please. We love you. Just mention us. Robert, Cody, Katie.
And so this week we're talking about an audience pick. We picked 10 picks from all our audience picks that
we got.
Thank you. Yes, thank you for some great picks in there.
Yeah.
And we picked 10, and then we rolled the dice to get one of those 10.
And one of those was, we did not get Monty Python and the Holy Grail, which should be on this list, but there is Molly for Brian, which actually is probably a better movie, but that's a whole different discussion for a different episode.
Maybe next week.
Maybe.
We'll find out at the end of this episode.
Maybe.
But this week, Jason, we're talking about one of the audience picks called... they selected 2013's Under the Skin, directed by Jonathan Glazer.
Our buddy!
Yeah,
we just got two Kingsleys, now we got two Glazers.
So we just talked about a few weeks ago with Sexy Beast.
Yes.
So, ladies and gentlemen, Under the Skin. That very haunting, eerie theme music, it can only be one thing, Jason.
It's Under the Skin! Sunday, Sunday, Sunday!
That's right.
Rev up your engines! Your van engines! Coming this Saturday at the Expo Super Show!
So, I'm gonna ask you for once... Since this is a movie that you have seen before and I have not, Brendan.
This is my second time watching it.
Second time watching this movie. What is this fucking movie about? Well, first of all, this movie, I'm going to go through the cast. Scarlett Johansson. Okay. So the movie is...
Well, no, that's not true. There is one person that I recognized outside of Scarlett Johansson. And the gentleman, the first gentleman she abducts, don't know his name.
Mm-hmm.
I probably could have looked it up. Mm-hmm. But I'm not conscientious like that, so fuck off. But that guy,
wow!
I'm pretty sure I've seen that guy on numerous episodes of 8 out of 10 Cats, a British panel show that I enjoy quite a bit.
You may have.
Yes.
But I can tell you what this movie is about. It's barest of bones.
It is. It really is.
It is a film about a woman
mm-hmm.
who we're led to believe is some sort of alien
mm-hmm.
being, something from another planet.
Now, this is Neverly... Neverly?
Neverly...
This is Neverly explicitly said.
No, Neverly told...
Neverly told to anybody.
But you've Neverly watched this movie before.
No, I've never watched this movie before, but I knew that this was a thing. Now, my question was, is when this movie originally came out, was this a known... Like, was this in the blurb in the program saying, Scarlett Johansson, an alien, engages in something on Earth?
I believe it was.
So that's good.
I believe this is known to be Scarlett Johansson playing an alien.
Okay.
Yeah.
Because right out of the gate, watching this movie, the first thing that occurred to me is, I am so glad that I know she's an alien. Because if I didn't know that fact, if I'd gone into this movie completely cold, I would have been so put off, like having no fucking clue what was going on. Like, it would have seemed like some sort of student art film where it's just like, it's just weird for being weird. I don't know what's even going on. But then having that context, then I'm able to keep track of everything out of the gate. I'm like, okay, she's an alien. That other guy, he's probably an alien too. Riding around on his motorbike.
Well, so this movie, she is an alien
mm-hmm.
of some kind. We don't know a lot of details other than that.
They don't say nothing about that.
Nope. She's from another planet, comes to Earth, and we get the basic idea that her goal is to kidnap male
passersby, not necessarily hitchhikers, just stops and picks them up. And of course, she's Scarlett Johansson, yeah. So many a man is very grateful to get into the car with her, to the van with her.
But it's the thing. I feel like every one of those guys, except for maybe the guy that yelled at her from the car, Andrew, I think he's the one guy that had a name in the movie. Mm-hmm. I think just about everybody expresses a little bit of hesitation before getting into the car with her.
Sure.
And I wonder if that's just a cultural, like, because these people are of ages that grew up with the idea of, like, hey, it's real dumb to get into strangers' cars, so there's always that little hesitation.
I mean, I think they're also like, why would this beautiful woman...
Yes, well, exactly. And yeah. It's an immediately a suspicious situation, especially if you're not... Like, if you're a super attractive dude and you know it, and a hot lady says, hey, get in my Corvette, you're probably just like, whatever, babe, sure. But, like, if you're just a normal-looking guy, like me, or a super ugly guy like Brendan, it's gonna trigger.
Wait a second. I just like nodded my head at first.
Nodded along.
Yeah, of course. Of course. Continue.
It's gonna trigger suspicion because it's like, I mean, she seems lovely, but what's her angle? What's her game?
Well, so
and maybe that's unfair, but as an average looking guy, and again, you as a monster, probably understand what I'm talking about.
Yes, I am a monster.
A monster.
So
my purpose in this podcast is actually a con. It's a big con to destroy Brendan's self-esteem.
It's a real long con. It's slowly breaking me down over the past, like, what, 38 to 75 episodes?
Absolutely.
But anyway, back to the plot that I was trying to break down really quickly. So she is an alien. She's picking up these men and bringing them to some kind of area where
Charlie Rose's office.
Yeah, of course. Charlie Rose's office. She's bringing them into this kind of pool where they're being evaporated. Mm. And I believe their meat is being sent somewhere. The movie doesn't tell you a whole lot.
Well,
now,
we'll talk about the context later. But as of, in the movie, we don't know. We get a vague suggestion that they've been popped and that the insides are then filtered out somewhere and sent somewhere.
So after many times of doing this, eventually she starts to kind of take a second look at human existence. She sees kind of a little more nuance than she was seeing at first. She starts to be drawn in. Then she kind of wants to become a part of it. Mm. And then that ultimately ends in tragedy, which I actually do want to just save until we get there.
Yeah.
But yeah, it's very... If we were just to describe the plot, this episode would be 5 minutes long.
Yeah.
Because there is not a lot of plot, but there's a lot of building to it. Actually, I want to say right out of the gate, you know what movie came to mind when I watched this?
Probably not the same one that came to my mind.
Well, it might not be conventional, but I thought of 2001 A Space Odyssey.
Okay.
Just in the terms of, like, these are some long, drawn-out scenes.
Similar pacing, yeah. Similar tone in that way.
Similar pacing, yeah. Similar tone. Music, I thought, was kind of similar. Like
this movie was definitely more sci-fi, like almost like 50s-ish in some of the tropes it uses.
Yeah, but the use of like mechanical type sound, like sounding music, and like slow zooms, and like the movie literally starts with this tiny, tiny circle of light slowly comes into frame, and I mean, it starts with her sounding out her like letters.
Which at first I assumed was her speaking an alien language.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I don't know if that was what they were trying to kind of fake you out with, but that's what my impression was. But then as it goes on, it's like she goes from making sounds to making like longer sounds to making words, you know?
Right.
And learning our terrible language.
So, yeah. So I want to, like, overall, I think this movie is both kind of hating on the human race, mm-hmm. and also kind of admiring it.
Yeah.
I think it's a both minds here. Because you start out with Scarlett Johansson is like essentially a villain.
Yeah.
I mean, she's kidnapping men and killing them and processing their meat.
Well, we assume at least yes.
In the second half of the film, though, it kind of takes a really interesting turn. Mm. In a lesser movie, I feel like this would just be like, you know, a government cover-up.
Yeah.
And, like, you know, they have to send in the scientists and shit. But it takes an interesting turn in that she is kind of like, well, she starts to feel empathy. She starts to be led into, like, the human race. Like, she kind of buys into it. And ultimately is duped by that.
Yeah.
Like, she, that ultimately becomes her undoing.
Yeah.
Which is kind of fucked up. Like, it's kind of an interesting message. I feel like Jonathan Glazer's not a real big fan of how humanity.
Well.
But at the same time, there's some stuff that he kind of, like, shows as, like, a genuine positive aspects of humanity.
See, now, don't you wish they did a crossover where Scarlett Johansson picks up Dawn?
What a movie would be.
That would be the best.
They both don't know how to interact with each other.
So where are you from? Oh, don't fucking... Don't know where I'm fucking from. Where are you from? Where are you so fucking fancy you're from?
Are we going to fuck or what?
Do you want to do this or what?
I feel like Don Logan would be Deadsville.
Yeah, no, absolutely. Well, he would just immediately go back to her house with her. He wouldn't, no question. And then we'd see Ben Kingsley's Wang.
Sweet. We do see a lot of Wangs in this movie.
Yes, it's a Wang-filled film. But also, we see Scarlett Johansson naked too, so it's balanced out.
But, I mean, I think that's the first thing I want to talk about, that is the nudity in this movie is rampant.
Yeah.
But it's very, like...
No, it's very clean.
Not clean. Appealing at all. No, I mean, I'm not saying... Scarlett Johansson's a gorgeous woman.
Yeah.
She's obviously very attractive. But
and looking great in this movie.
Looking great, but like when I see her in the shots, like where she's looking herself in the mirror, like that scene's like, I don't know, an hour or so into the movie.
You managed to restrain yourself?
I mean, I didn't really... It was weird. Like, the movie worked you over so much.
Yeah, there's no eroticism in any of it.
No, it's just like it strips her of her personality too.
Yeah.
Throughout the movie. And so at that point, you're just like... That's a naked person. Like it's like you feel like you're reading like a medical book.
She's wearing a shell. She's wearing a skin. You know.
She's under the skin.
He said it. She didn't because she doesn't say much.
Flip, flip, flam.
I'd love to know how many words are said in this movie because there's not many.
8.
Oh,
there's definitely more than 8.
This movie's just 6 words long.
Jason, before we kind of unravel this movie a little more, do you want to know how this movie kind of came to be?
Yeah, please inform me.
Okay. So, we talked about Sexy Beast.
Yeah.
And this was the movie that actually Jonathan Glazer wanted to make after Sexy Beast. But he didn't really start working on it until after production of his second film, Birth,
mm-hmm.
which I described also has a very weird plot.
Yeah.
But Glazer wanted to adapt the novel Under the Skin, but he had no interest in doing a direct adaptation. And just to give you an idea of what that kind of book was about.
Mm.
So the protagonist is a character named...
But before we start this, I want to point out that after having watched this movie and then gone and looked at the summary of the book, it really did fill in a lot of gaps for me as far as like kind of like explicitly stating what the purpose of everything was that was going on in this movie. And as a sci-fi fan, that was really cool. But maybe as a film fan, I don't know that it benefits from the context. So if you really like this movie and just don't want to hear it, maybe turn off the podcast right now and don't listen to any of this context.
Wow.
So you can maintain your illusion of what this movie is. But if you want to hear about what it's actually about, we'll talk.
Well, I don't know if this is what it's actually about, though, because I think Jonathan Glazer kind of abandoned the idea of the book in many ways.
Yes, but based on the summary I read, I haven't read the book, but based on the summary I read, he hits a lot of the same notes and ideas that are in that book, mm-hmm. but he just doesn't... drill down into the Star Trek episode sci-fi-ness that the book has.
Well, in the book, the main character is very obviously an alien. They make it very obvious.
Well, I think it straight up says. I believe her name is Iserly.
She's collecting hitchhikers for meat,
mm-hmm.
and she hunts with several other people, so she's not just by herself.
The biker dude is her boss name, I think, Esmus.
Right. So there's even a point where a victim is writing mercy in the sand and she pretends to not be able to not understand English in a way that she kind of feels some sort of empathy, but she like pretends not to.
Well, she, in the book, there's an incident, I believe, where another of her species shows up and releases a bunch of humans. And so this incident you're talking about here, where the one writes mercy in the sand before they kill them and she pretends not to understand English, but she ends up talking to this guy. He's like the son of a high placed politician. And he's like, yeah, you don't understand. These people are more like us than you would believe. I mean, we shouldn't just be using them for meat. It's very like an animal rights take, I guess, almost. But like the aliens in the book, as I understand, relate more to like the four-legged creatures because they are canids themselves, kind of dog-like creatures who then go through, well, specifically Iserly and Esmus go through very painful surgery to assume the form of humans. And so they're always in pain.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, but they're doing that specifically to go to the planet, to be undercover, to harvest people, and then sell the meat to the elites back in her society who pay a lot of money for this stuff. Yeah, so it's all very like, it's all, like I say, it's like a real good episode of Star Trek, but it's all very like explicit and laid out like you would expect a sci-fi novel to be. And this takes so many of those ideas and just kind of says, here, it's happening. Just mm-hmm. watch it and tell me what you think.
Well, and this is the thing. It's kind of similar because, I mean, there is a scene where she's raped by a hitchhiker and she has a change of heart at one point and lets someone go. And then, you know, this man's dog who she kidnaps is trapped in a van and she lets that dog go.
Yeah.
And eventually she learns about reincarnation. Mm. So she crashes the car with her and another victim. And because she has to get rid of the evidence because they don't want anybody to know that there's aliens on this planet, she basically blows everything up, including herself. She Will Smiths
herself from Legend, yeah.
I Am Legend, yeah. Spoiler alert.
Well, but yeah, no, she does that, which is an interesting ending to the book. But it also, that enlightened me, because then it's like, okay, I get the end of the movie a little more, because she's becoming disillusioned with the job, which is what happens in the book.
But back to Jonathan Glazer adapting this, he said, I don't want to do that. Mm. I want to adapt it, but I want to kind of put my own spin on it. I don't want to like necessarily Stanley Kubrick this source material.
Well,
but
and if you were going to do this book like true to its source material, it would be a big budget sci-fi epic.
Well, that's the thing. So originally this was supposed to be a big budget adaptation. And actually, this is kind of crazy. It was originally going to center around a husband and wife alien couple posing as farmers. Brad Pitt was even cast as the husband. I'm not saying anything against Brad Pitt.
Yeah, but sure, like, he'd be great alien.
However, it took so long to get off the ground that Jonathan Glazer was like, just forget it. And now,
Brad Pitt probably smoked enough weed that he did forget it.
And now Jonathan Glazer is like, you know what? We're going to cut the main character. We're going to cut the male character. We're going to focus only on the female character and her point of view. And Jonathan Glazer and his writing partner, Walter Campbell, they co-wrote the script together. They went through the script and deleted every part of the script that called for any kind of big budget moment. And they deleted every part of the script that did not involve the female. Mm-hmm. And then they kind of, you know, just kind of added things here and there. But they cut all the big budget stuff. Yeah. They cut all the non-main character stuff. And this also helped him secure funding. So he went through a number of actors. Like, you got to... Jonathan Glazer, I mean, he's coming off Sexy Beast, he's coming off Birth with her, are not like, you know, huge moneymakers, but this guy's got some cred, especially from Sexy Beast, because Ben Kingsley is like, you know, he fucking
one of the best performances of his career.
Nominated for an Oscar, right? So he has people like Gemma Arterton, Eva Green, January Jones, Abby Cornish, Olivia Wilde, who I actually think Olivia Wilde would have been really good in this movie. They're all considered, and Gemma Arterton actually, this is kind of sad, but she actually gets the part. And then the studio is like, we're not giving you the money unless you get a big name star. And Gemma Arterton, unfortunately, has to step aside. Mm-hmm. They do give it to Scarlett Johansson.
Yeah.
Who, by the way, this is... There's no question. Mm. This is one of the best. Now, I'm not saying she's a bad actress by any stretch.
No, like, she's an amazing actress.
She, Lost in Translation.
I'm going to say this right now, Brendan. Scarlett Johansson can play anybody.
Yeah.
Now, whether she should play anybody is a great question that I'm not going to sit here and answer, but the fact is that she can play anybody.
All right, let's not ghost in the shell. But yeah, she's a fantastic actress, and what's really fascinating about this is that she kind of like strips away everything that kind of makes her a star in this movie.
Hmm.
Like, she doesn't act or carry herself like a Hollywood star.
Well, she puts on a British accent, though.
It's a great British accent. It's
very good. Very good, like, just posh. A little bit like, oh, hello, yes, I'm looking for directions. Yes, hello.
Yeah, and so, I mean, she took, 4 years, okay, to learn to drive on the other side of the road.
Took her 4 years?
Well, no, she had four years to prep.
Okay.
And, like, learn how to drive the van, perfect her British accent. And I think it's fantastic. And she's cast in this part. So, despite her being a huge star... I don't know if you know this, but all these scenes where she's walking through town, these are not extras.
Mm.
These are just people.
Yeah, I heard that about this movie.
People not recognizing her.
Yeah.
That's insane. I mean, she doesn't quite look all glammed up and
everything. And she's wearing a wig, and she doesn't look like Scarlett Johansson, the blonde movie star that you saw in the Marvel movies.
So Jonathan Glazer casts a lot of other... He makes a lot of interesting casting choices in this movie. He also casts a road racer named Jeremy McWilliams to play, like, the driver, who he's known as. Because no one's really given a name in this movie.
Oh, you mean the biker guy?
The biker.
Yeah.
He was a motocross biker. Like, he was able to basically... He needed someone... Jonathan Glazer wanted someone to be able to drive during, like, these treacherous roads at top speed. So he needed to get an actual...
So they could save money. They wouldn't have to hire a stuntman.
Right. And I mean, they I don't think he has a single line. Nope. So
He does kind of dress her down at one point. At least that's the implication I got, where she's standing there and he's kind of walking around her and they seem to be communicating in telepathic, Talosian style communication.
Yeah. So and Scarlett Johansson is driving this van around. She has a generator in the back.
Mm.
All the cruise equipment is in the back. She's basically the gaffer.
Yeah,
carrying, you know, everyone's stuff. And the crew had to build their own cameras at times, like build their own setups. All the people, by the way, that she's picking up.
Yeah.
Almost all the people that she's picking up and talking to on the streets, real people.
I believe the guys she actually you see taking back, like she actually takes back and puts in the liquid, those are actors.
Well, maybe not. I believe they, okay, so when they get into the car, when they get into the van with her,
yeah,
they are real people.
Yeah.
All of those people are real, except for one, which we'll get into later.
Well, there's that, the first Scottish guy she picks up is, like I say, I know him from
but British I still TV. Believe he is, he did not know he was being filmed.
Hmm.
So everybody except for one major character was a person that Scarlett Johansson specifically drove around and like she basically was like, okay, let's talk to this guy. They have hidden cameras in the van. And then once they get into the van, they have their conversation. After they kind of ended it, that's when the director would come up and be like, okay, listen, this is a movie. Here's some release papers.
This is Scarlett Johansson you've been riding with.
Yeah, hey. By the way, this is Scarlett Johansson. Now, if you want to go further with this, we can go shoot this scene. It will, you know, necessitate nudity. So here is, like, you know, an extra contract to sign. And I believe, so anybody that's in that scene started out not knowing.
Hmm.
Once they're in that scene, they obviously know they're in a movie. But, like, when they're in the car, all those people in the van, except for one, no idea.
What was the one guy specifically, the dude with the face?
Yeah.
Yeah. So I read a little bit about him.
Yeah, so we'll definitely talk about that more. So anyway, Jonathan Glazer, it took 12 years to make this movie. From conception to finished product, 12 years. Because Sexy Beast was 2000. 2001, he started writing it.
I was trying to think of another example of movies like that. And there have been, but I can't think of one offhand. But I know
there's not too many, though.
Well, just where the script's been kicking around for so long. I'm sure you've heard of the Hollywood Blacklist, right?
Yeah,
like those sorts of scripts that where they just look. There's that one script that's been sitting around for like 40 years, and apparently it's like one of the best scripts ever written, but nobody's ever made it into a movie.
So, I mean, where do you want to start? Where do you want to start with this movie? Because there's a lot of different things we can get into. I mean, should we just get like the look of the film?
Yeah, okay. So this movie takes place in Scotland. So this whole movie has a very gloomy pallor to
very
it.
Very local hero.
That I've never been to Scotland, but I feel like a Scottish person would look this movie and go, "Aye, that's Scotland."
And some of the accents of the locals are very hard to distinguish.
Oh man, the bus driver, man, trying to figure out what he was saying. Yeah. I couldn't make out a word.
And this movie is very deliberate. The pacing is very slow mm-hmm. and steady, but it unfolds like a beautiful.
As I mentioned on almost every episode, I love the movie Once Upon a Time in the West, so a slow-paced movie is no problem for this guy.
Yeah. So, I mean, even from the get-go, from the beginning, I think it's a good solid, 15 to 20 minutes before I think we get a single line.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh, also, so right at the beginning, I was reminded of, that's the thing, like, I keep thinking of other sci-fi movies when I'm watching this and comparing them and how, like, at the very beginning of the movie, you have the vans there and the guy pulls up on the bike, he goes down in the ditch, he pulls out a dead hooker, goes up, puts her in the van. And I'm thinking, like, this is so different. And then she goes and takes her clothes and whatever and assumes kind of her look, because it's not the same person. I thought it was Scarlett Johansson maybe on the ground at first, but no, it was actually a different actress altogether. But it's like, compare that to, like, Terminator, where he's just like, give me your boots and your gun, mm-hmm. or give me your boots and your motorcycle.
So, and we don't ever really learn the function of this biker, what he's all about specifically, like I say, other than he seems to cover up the evidence.
Yeah, I got the impression that he was her like direct boss,
like her handler.
Yeah,
yeah, he seems to cover up the evidence, and he seems to be her boss.
Yeah.
So, but what's interesting is like when he takes that woman up into the back of the van, and she like you know puts her clothes on and stuff. I got the feeling that was the previous alien. That was the previous alien that failed. And I think this is just a cycle of... Because, I mean, she like we said, she goes from, like, you know, she's in this world. She's collecting she's collecting men. We don't know why.
Yeah.
But they're harvesting their meat for some reason. She becomes kind of, like, empathetic to humans. Ultimately, it ends in her dying.
Yeah.
And I think this is just,
like, it's just the cycle that happens. I think at a certain point, it's inevitable that the hand or the person that's going out and harvesting humans is going to get empathetic to them.
Yeah. I honestly think it just keeps happening.
Yeah.
And they're just going through these, like, you know, these test subjects very quickly.
Well, because I believe in the book, too, they have a part about her insisting on being shown how they're processed and being taken to a factory and getting real angry when they won't show her, like, the final end of the process or something. Like,
And in the book, I think it's a lot more, too, about, like, food processing. There's a lot of messages about, like, fast food and, like, how we kind of, like, animal cruelty and stuff like that. Like,
I bet the author was happy that message got it completely ejected from the movie.
I mean, it's kind of Jonathan Glazer's. I mean, we know from watching Sexy Beast, Jonathan Glazer, like, kind of does his own thing. Like, he doesn't.
Oh, absolutely.
He doesn't. He actually said in an interview here. Let me just pull this up here, because he actually said that. He would never, ever, 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 ever want to make a movie with universal acclaim. Mm-hmm. He said, if I ever made a movie that people just agreed on, I would feel like a failure.
Yeah, I see that. Because, that means lowest common denominator kind of stuff. Usually it's rare that a movie that everybody loves is also, like, a truly good movie.
Yeah, I mean, happens. I mean, it happens, of course. Oh, like, yeah. You know, there's many Quentin Tarantino movies that most people love, and they're great. But, I mean, there's a lot of movies that, I think he wants to stir discussion.
So I think the problem is that if he did ever want to do a movie that was, like, as big as a Quentin Tarantino movie, then Jonathan Glazer has to take up doing a whole mountain of cocaine. I think that's the secret to Quentin Tarantino's success. And to Hollywood's machinations.
I don't know about Jonathan Glazer's cocaine use, but ramp it up.
Yeah, get going, bud. Like, just dive in. We want to see what you have.
This movie. Okay, so would you, if you had to name a genre for this movie, would you say horror?
I don't know that I found it horrifying. Actually, the only scene that truly horrified me was the scene on the beach.
Yeah. So let's talk about that a little bit. Because that I wrote down at, like, literally just under its own subheading, disturbing scenes.
Oh,
because,
absolutely.
So she goes to the beach and she's having a conversation. She's clearly picked out a victim.
Yeah.
This guy who kind of just lives on the beach.
And again, with the context I know from the book, like, this is part of her, like, essentially assessing people. She's trying to find people that don't have any connections, that won't be missed, that can just kind of disappear and won't cause too many waves.
Which I think there's a couple scenes of her talking to people in the van that do have connections, and she kind of just lets them go.
Yeah.
She's talking to this guy and she's doing her kind of vetting process.
Yeah.
And then the diver looks out and he sees that, you know, a husband and wife are caught out in the ocean.
Yeah.
They're drowning.
The wife has gone out after the dog who got caught out in the water, and the husband has run off the beach after the wife, leaving his young son or daughter, I don't know, but young baby
on the
beach.
Yeah. On the beach, yeah. So the diver goes out. And he manages to get the husband, but the wife is still out there. And the diver's kind of collapses just out of exhaustion.
Yeah.
And the husband goes back out to save the wife. So you know that husband is doomed. Like, they're both going to drown. And the diver just kind of collapses. Scarlett Johansson walks over, takes a rock, and just fucking thwacks him in the head.
Yeah, just full on, like, almost like... And it's disturbing because it's not like... It's the kind of scene you would see in a cartoon. But it's for real. She just grabs a rock and fucking knocks him on the head.
It's not stylistically edited. It's not cutaway.
It's not funny.
It's not funny. It's not gory. No. It's just...
It's just then, that sound, the right sound, just a clunk, you know?
Yep. And then as she's dragging him away, we see the baby crying, being left alone on the beach. That baby is doomed because the parents are going to die, obviously. Yeah. The thing that makes this the most disturbing, though, is that later on, this is the daytime, we see at night the biker comes back to, like, get rid of the evidence and stuff, and the baby is still there.
Yes.
And the biker just ignores it completely. Like, that child, and you linger on that,
like,
child.
You kind of hope that he would take the baby and do something with it, like kill it or process it or something just to deal with it. Like,
nothing.
But no, just leaves it on the
And
beach.
You linger on that child in a shot. Like, you see that baby is, like, I don't know. I mean, I know babies can't really technically act, I guess, but, like...
No, but that baby's pissed.
That was some good baby acting.
Yeah.
That was some
that
solid...
baby deserves one of the baby Oscars this year.
All right, the Academy Award for Best Baby goes to the baby from Under the Skin. Under the Skin Jr.
2013, from 6 years ago. We're finally recognizing this kid, and we'll haul this 7-year-old kid up onto the screen and be like, I don't remember any of this.
And then even more disturbing later, Jason, for me anyway, is when you hear the news report about the family, and then you hear that it's missing.
Yeah, exactly. The baby's missing. Where the fuck did the baby go? The baby was right there.
So the baby just, like, end up in the water? Like, did the biker, did we not see the biker maybe do something about the baby?
Did some
like,
desperate mother steal that baby?
We don't know.
There's a whole other movie about that baby that Jonathan Glazer needs to make.
Yeah, it's called Baby's Day Out.
That's right.
It's all about
so that's what you have to assume. If you just assume that Baby's Day Out starts as soon as that baby is left on the beach and he's like taken to the city. And then Joe Mantegna shows up and it's a whole
I thought you were
going
to say
time.
Joey Pants.
I was, but then I realized it was, no, it was Joe Mantegna that was in that movie. Fat Tony
and then
himself.
Joey Pants shows up and he...
Hey, she was a whore, Johnny, a whore.
He turncoats on Keanu Reeves and...
Whoa, I'm in cyberpunk.
But yeah, that scene is fucking disturbing.
That's the hardest scene in the movie to watch to me. And then, like I said, yeah, no gore or anything. Just no. Like, just so disturbing.
Just
it's like, but it's with babies, right? It's sometimes with babies, like, of course, you know, there's God Bless America where they shoot the baby with a shotgun in the beginning. That's hilarious. But where conversely, you know, like you watch Trainspotting, which we'll watch at some point because it's on the list, but like the baby crawling on the ceiling, and that's fucking nuts. Like, that's crazy.
I mean, that baby dies too, doesn't it?
That's even the more disturbing part beyond that is when they walk up to the cradle in that movie and the woman just starts like screaming because the baby's been dead because they've all been high on heroin for 2 days.
Yeah.
But we'll talk about that when we talk about Trainspotting starring Ewan McGregor as Obi-Wan Kenobi.
Don't know if that casting is correct.
I think that's how it is.
So, I mean, I think we should maybe take a listen. I'm going to be frank with everyone right now. There's not a lot of clips I can play. There's not very much dialogue.
Let's just say this, though, out of the gate. Right now, folks, this movie has incredible sound design.
Incredible sound design.
I watched 3/4 of this movie before my lovely wife got out of bed and wanted to watch the last bit of it with me and was thoroughly confused. I watched the first 3/4 of this movie with my headphones on, my nice Sony Platinum headphones.
All right, Jason, we don't need that.
It was lovely. It was wonderful. The sound design is so... I would put it up there with somebody like David Lynch. Like, it's just such great, like stuff going on, you know, on my Sony Platinum headphones.
God damn it. Sony Platinum, a sponsor of this podcast.
Well, they could be if they would send me a gift card for Sony products in the amount of $120 plus tax, which is what I paid for that headset from Digital World. If you need to pawn something, Digital World is there for you.
I believe it's the deals are here.
455cash.com.
Stop it.
I'm trying to work us an advertising deal, Brendan. Sometimes you got to take initiative.
But yeah, so like I said, I don't have there's not a whole lot of clips we could play. It's a very visual movie.
Yes.
But I do want to play one clip of one of her conversations in the van as she picks up a fella.
Hi.
Lost.
Yeah, I'm looking for the M8.
Up for the roundabout.
Are you walking?
Left. Yep.
Where are you walking to?
Home.
Oh, you're going home? To your family?
No, just myself.
Just yourself?
It's great.
Yeah, why?
Can do whatever I like.
So where are you coming from?
Govan, right there.
Sorry?
Govan.
Govan? Did you work there?
No. Don't work there, I work for myself.
Do you want a lift?
Why not?
You'll have to tell me how to get there.
Just follow this road straight up.
Okay. Sure. So what do you do?
Electrician.
Oh, you're an electrician. Oh. It's cold, right?
It's a wee bit nippy, aye.
Yeah.
So what is it you're doing?
I'm just driving just some furniture for my family.
All right.
So you live alone?
Yes.
And you love it?
That is great.
What do you love about living alone?
You can be a bit naggy.
Do I go straight through?
Yeah, just straight through. Straight through the whole way.
So if you're wondering why that didn't sound like a movie, that's because that's a genuine conversation she's having with a random guy.
Who apparently was walking along the side of the highway.
Yeah, and I love how, and you hear the vetting process too.
Yeah.
You're her saying like, oh, you live alone. Do you like living alone?
And this is the first guy she picks up.
Yeah, and then they don't even show what happens to him.
No.
They cut, and then he's not in the car.
Yeah.
And so it's interesting, you're kind of like, so it kind of leaves you like wondering at first, like what's going on with these passengers?
What I was interested in that scene was that her, I feel like she didn't think about her story
Like when he asks about her, that for some reason she hadn't considered like the idea of a backstory for her, and she's just kind of like, "Oh yeah, I'm moving some furniture for my family."
Yeah, because if you notice throughout the movie, her kind of backstory gets a little better.
Yeah, she gets better at it.
Can we talk about ultimately what happens when these guys get lured? Because those scenes were. Yeah, incredibly
really cool. Effective. So again, we go back to Charlie Rose's office. It's all black. That's just how I've described it in all my notes, is Charlie Rose's office. And she basically, and it's very weird because she goes into like an apartment and then all of a sudden it's all black and they start walking and she's like drawing them forward like a spider.
Mm-hmm. Jason's looking at me really strange right
like
now.
A spider, Brendan, like in Dr. No.
Scarlett Johansson is Charlotte's Web.
That's right. But yeah, she draws him in and she like is walking backwards and they're walking forwards. And then at some point they start sinking into the ground, which is reflective and looks like a liquid and oil or something.
Like a pool almost.
Yeah, a pool or something. And they don't seem to realize that they're going into the pool.
It's like they're kind of under a trance.
Yeah, they're staring at her delicious body and can't take their eyes off her because and then they sink into a pool. And the first time we see this, he just goes into the pool and she just leaves and goes about her business.
Yeah, and then we kind of see later when a second guy ends up in the pool and he sees another man from earlier. He sees the diver from earlier, I believe.
I thought it was the Scottish guy she picked up, but it's hard to tell because the guy is so weirdly deformed.
He's been in the water so long.
Tenderized,
his skin is starting to fall apart. Yeah. And he watches. And this, Jason, I timed it. This is a minute... I believe it's a minute and a half of silence.
Yeah.
There is no sound. There is no music. There is no dialogue where he just watches this guy disintegrate in the water while he is just like, he's just been brought into the water. He even kind of looks up and he sees like Scarlett Johansson standing there and he just watches it. And I'm like, this movie has the fucking balls. Even if I didn't like this movie, which I love this movie. Yeah. But even if I didn't like it, this movie has the fucking balls to go silent for a minute and a fucking half.
Yeah. And it works because it builds up to this guy just suddenly popping.
Yeah.
Like it's like, it's just almost like an explosion and he just kind of like implodes. He like explodes and then implodes. And it's just literally the remnants of his skin floating. And they hold on that for like 30 seconds, it felt like.
Yeah.
Like straight up just holding on this like skin floating through the water. And you could see like his hand and his foot and his face and everything.
And this is when you also see like the kind of like processing plant.
Yeah.
Because we see like the red... The red, like,
processing plant, it literally is like a shaft of red material going into a slot. That is the most impression we get, but it's enough to get across the idea of, like, oh, it's just all being sloughed out.
Guys, this movie does not spoon feed anything to you. If you think you're going into this and you're going to get solid answers, you're sorely mistaken.
Mm.
Like, this movie is not about that at all.
See, you can always go and read the novel if you want more clarification, folks. Check it out at your local library. Libraries brought to you by For Screen and Country. We're sponsoring libraries, Brendan. That's what we're doing now. We're sponsoring libraries.
I believe reading is the scourge of the future.
That's right. So head to the library and be part of the scourge of the future.
Oh, we're going to have to pause for a second. Like, the hiccups. We should definitely talk about Adam Pearson.
Yes, Adam Pearson, absolutely.
So, there's a little bit of story behind this. So, one of the men she picks up, the director said, this is one of the few people I want an actual actor.
Yeah.
And it was supposed to be a man with a deformity, a facial deformity. And Jonathan Glazer said, but I don't want someone with prosthetics. I really appreciate what he did here.
No, I do too.
It's like, there are people out there with like facial deformities who are actors.
Mm-hmm.
They know how to act. This guy actually apparently had not really done that much acting. He wasn't really too much into the acting, but he went out and found this guy named Adam Pearson who actually has a facial deformity to play a man with a facial deformity. Now, the thing with Adam Pearson is like, he might be like, aside from Scarlett Johansson, because I think she has to carry this movie. She's obligated to carry this movie. He might be he's definitely the next most effective performer.
Well, he certainly has the most dialogue of anybody besides her. And again, that is not a whole lot, but
no. But he is like, he's so like natural and genuine. Mm. And as a comparison point, especially to the scene we just played where she's talking to another guy, I do want to play a little bit of their conversation where her seductive methods for him are a little different. So let's just listen to that, a little bit of that.
When was the last time you had a girlfriend?
Never have one.
So don't you get lonely then? You have very nice hands. You have beautiful hands.
So, again, I only played a little bit of dialogue there, and that's because apparently, to kind of help Scarlett Johansson with this scene, Adam Pearson was giving her a lot of things that she could tell him that someone in his situation would maybe be a lot more moved by.
Yeah.
So she's not necessarily saying things like, "Oh, you got a great smile. Oh, yeah. you're a looker." Because like that's something that someone like him would be like, "Okay, whatever."
Yeah, it sounds
like,
condescending. I'm sure
it's condescending. But she's kind of complimenting other features, yeah, like, "Oh, you have beautiful hands." Yeah. "Oh, you know, you don't have a girlfriend. Why don't you have a girlfriend?" Like she sounds very genuine, and that's because her character is genuine. Mm. She honestly does not know why he's like.
Yeah.
What do you mean? Do I have a girlfriend? Like I'm in my situation right now. Why would I have a girlfriend?
And for her, I mean, as an alien, to her, humans all look the same, regardless of whether they're deformed or not. I have to imagine, like, it's just they look like food animals as far as she's concerned. And I have to give credit where credit is due, Mr. Pearson. There, he's a very good actor, and. I get the sense that he's like, he gets into this van with her and he has this hesitation. You can tell in the back of his mind, he's like, why is this beautiful girl interested in me?
Yeah.
Like I've been, and maybe in his life, he's been fucked over like that before. I mean, I know the actor himself brought in a lot of his own experience with bullying and such to this role. And I think he's done a lot with stuff since this role with that. And it's been helped by being in this movie. He really embodies a guy who like is so desperate for affection, but also is smart enough to, you know, be suspicious of it.
Yeah. And I mean, she catches him as he's going to grocery shop in the middle of the night because basically he won't be bothered.
Yeah.
And I mean, he's wearing a hoodie. He's covering his face for the most part. And it's really interesting in this scene because you kind of see her break him down a little bit in terms of like getting him to be more relaxed because he slowly takes his hood down. He starts to look at her because for the while he's looking at the window. He's not really making eye contact. He's making a lot more eye contact. She holds his hand, like they hold hands at one point. So she's it's kind of a great scene. It might be my favorite scene in the whole movie.
Yeah.
Because she kind of like she psychologically seduces him, and it's so different from every other scene.
And it goes different for him too, because when he gets to the place and she takes him into the thing and he leads him into the water, she gives him the full show. He gets to see everything. None of the other guys got to actually see her like naked.
Mm-hmm.
Like she was in the process of taking her clothes off, but they never got a full look. She gives him a full look.
Do you think that's because though that like she had to do that to convince him that it was for real?
Maybe, but it worked out for him.
Well, does it though?
Because, I mean, it does until it doesn't.
Yeah, because like, this is the turning point of the movie too, because she seduces him. He gets up in the pool, but then she has a scene where she goes down the stairs and she looks at a mirror.
Mm.
And this is a scene, again, Jonathan Glazer is not shy about stretching out a scene.
Mm.
She stares at that mirror for a good solid minute.
Is that when she's looking at her face or when she's staring at herself naked?
Just at her face.
Oh, right, because that's later than naked. No, but yeah, and you can see like stuff moving underneath her face.
I honestly didn't even notice if that was happening. What I did notice though is that when she's looking in the mirror, there's a major focus on her eyes, and actually in general in this movie there's a lot of focus on her eyes.
She has great eyes.
She does have great eyes. And even like later when the biker is just kind of staring at her, he's making direct eye contact with her and he's looking right at her eyes, and it's almost like he's like checking to see if she's showing the signs of the previous person. Because I still think that woman was the previous person showing any kind of empathy.
See, I just looked at that as like he was telepathically communicating with her, that they were communicating in a way that we can't perceive. And he was essentially dressing her down, I think.
I mean, maybe, but I think it has something to do with her eyes, ultimately. Yeah.
Just being like, look, your job is to harvest meat for the rich people. The rich people matter, you don't. So harvest the meat.
It's all about...
Get them boys and harvest the meat.
Listen, it's all about the 1%.
That's right. We serve them. We bring them human meat and caviar and various gold-encrusted dildos.
Oh.
That's what rich people love.
All right.
I read an article once in The Economist, and that's what rich people love.
So I guess we should say in the second half of the film is when she kind of abandons her entire mission.
Yeah.
There's a scene where she's sitting in traffic and she gets a rose and it's from somebody in a van and she looks and there's blood on her hand. I didn't quite understand that part.
I wonder if that's maybe like her understanding that humans bleed almost. Like, I wonder if that's like it drives home to her this resonance of like, oh, these are actual beings. Like, they've got blood. Like
they're not just animals.
I assume whatever being she is has some equivalent. So seeing this blood on them and being like, huh, yeah. And the fact that somebody bought her a rose in traffic.
Is it her blood?
No, it's his blood, because we see a scene afterwards where she looks out into traffic and sees him with the flowers and can see the blood on his hand. And he's kind of like wrapping his hand up or wiping it off or whatever.
So it's the guy who gives her the flowers.
Yeah, it's the guy who gives her the flower because he's handling roses, right? So chances are he might get pricked every now and then.
Right. Okay, I kind
of
got that.
I also am the idea of buying a flower for somebody in traffic, is that a real thing? Does that happen in Britain? British listeners, if you're out there.
Listen, it's Scotland.
Or maybe big city listeners, because we live in a relatively small city in this country. So maybe in big cities people do that. Because I've heard of like I've seen like squeegee kids and the like that will come up and, you know, clean your window for a dime or whatever. Says the 75-year-old man. Yeah, dime bag.
Hey, Jason.
Here's some meth. Clean my window.
Jason.
Yeah.
Forget it, Jason. It's Scotland Town.
That's right. It is Scotland Town.
But that kind of triggers the second half of the film. Where she becomes the... It's kind of interesting, actually, now that I'm thinking about it, because she starts to feel empathy, and we start to feel empathy for her.
Yeah.
Because she kind of turns into, like, sort of a tragic figure, because she's being... Now she's like, okay, well, maybe what I'm doing is not so great. I'm going to try to blend in.
Yeah.
She goes to a restaurant and tries to eat cake.
Yeah,
because
lovely...
she's like... This is what a person would do, and immediately retches.
Yeah, and it's a lovely piece of standard chocolate cake that you would find, and I'm sure she was probably paid or probably had to pay 7 or 8 pounds for.
Yeah.
It was ridiculous because the restaurant had such a good view. You know the menu was fucking ridiculous, and that's something I need to talk about is that when... Just because the restaurant has a great view doesn't mean you got to charge an arm and a leg. Sometimes poor people want to have a nice experience, restaurant tours. Maybe you should have a special night for us poor people so that we can get a half-price meal and a good view. Think about us, okay? This is what this movie has brought upon me, is my desire to have a good view at a reasonable price.
Listen, listeners, you're just hearing this for the first time on the podcast. I hear this every day.
And another thing. I want a meatloaf special. Nobody has meatloaf anymore, Brendan.
That's right. But apparently, but at this point, she becomes basically... She's just walking around...
Yeah.
Taking everyone's word for it.
It's kind of like I was in my early 20s, just kind of wandering around and not really knowing what's going on.
Listening to every piece of advice she gets.
Yeah.
Like she walks around, she tries the cake, she retches. She walks around and this guy tells her, oh, if you want to wait for a bus, it's over there. And she just kind of, she has no idea what a bus is, but she just goes, okay, and just sits there and waits for the bus.
Where's she got all the money that she has? That's what I want to know.
I don't know.
Do they issue money from the Alien Space Command?
I feel like it's a non-issue.
Well, it is for me. I'm a Star Trek fan, Brendan. Details matter.
Well, then you picked the wrong movie. But she gets on the bus and she kind of gets into this weird, like, romantic relationship with the guy. He thinks it's a romantic relationship. She's just kind of going along with the flow.
Yeah.
And the scene is like she kind of had, I mean, she's going with it. They're kissing. Yeah. They're about to have sex.
And I was like, holy shit, she's actually going to fuck a guy.
And then she realizes she's not a human because her genitalia ain't right.
See, what I couldn't figure out, Brendan, was whether he just couldn't get in, like there was nothing there, or she was the one that was surprised by that was what was happening, because she then leaps off the bed and grabs a lamp and is staring at her crotch trying to figure out what's going on.
I don't think there's... I think there's nothing there, because I think the way he reacts first is just like he can't quite figure it out, and then she literally holds a lamp to her vagine.
Mm-hmm. Or what would be.
What would be a vagine. And is kind of perplexed as to what is there. Now, granted, you may be right about the other theory, because she never has sex with anyone else. She just lures them into the water, and they fucking get processed and become meat. But yeah, so, I mean, that happens, and then she immediately leaves. And I do want to play this. This is, I know we said previously that we're kind of changing the format. We don't really go in order. But at this point, I think we should just talk about the rest of the film.
Yeah, okay.
So she has this, like, conversation with a logger that she meets in the middle of the woods. And I want to play a little bit of this conversation here.
You stop for a ramble in the woods, sir? Yeah? Yes. You just off for a ramble in the woods? Yeah. Oh, it's, watch out your step here. It's a bit slippery around here, but, this time of year, it's all right in summer. Well, still wet in summer, but not as bad as it is now. But there's plenty of trails around here. Have you been here before? No, first time? Yeah? Oh, you won't get lost. They're all clearly marked. But there's about 2,000 acres of forest here, so you should have plenty of places to go in that. You on your own?
Yeah.
Yeah, on your own? Oh, it's a nice place if you want some solitude. You know, it's... gather your thoughts and all that. Yeah. So enjoy yourself anyway. Okay.
So ultimately, so this conversation, you know, it again feels very genuine, natural. Yeah. This guy was not an actor. This was just a guy who owned one of the locations they shot at.
Wow. Yeah. And they got him to do this.
Yeah.
Wow.
So this, I mean, eventually turns into a scene where he attempts to rape her.
Yeah. He just kind of comes out of nowhere and like grabs her. Well, she like kind of wanders out to a stone cabin in the woods and kind of passes
kind of,
out.
Kind of a rest stop for anybody passing through the mountains kind of thing.
Yeah. Because here's the thing, Britain. This is, or Britain.
Britain.
Here's the thing, Brendan.
My name is Britain.
Is that Britain has this wonderful thing called the, I think it's like the right of free passage or the right of free travel. And the idea is that people can own private property, but you as a citizen have the kind of right to travel through people's property in a way that we don't have here in North America. Mm-hmm. So, so you can just like go through these paths, and sometimes people have like things set up that you can go and like kind of take a rest at or whatever. And maybe that's what that is she's in this little like log cabin. She just kind of conks out for a nap and wakes up to this motherfucker coming back to rape her.
Well, he tries to.
So
the thing with this is like that I find like is kind of the most realistic aspect of this is like, you know, this conversation we just heard, it's a little bit awkward. It's a little bit, you know, not unnerving, but it's a little weird and stuff. But
it is weird to run into a random person in the middle of the fucking woods. Now, maybe she wouldn't know that because she's an alien and maybe she thinks that's normal. But
yeah. But I mean, it's probably weird. Like, I'm not saying, okay. I'm saying if you're that guy, it's also weird to just see this lady walk through the woods just very by strange. Herself. You know, this beautiful woman walking through all by herself. So it is a very weird scene. It's very awkward, but I would have never guessed that it would end up like this.
Yeah.
But I think that's also kind of the film making a statement where it's like, it doesn't always happen where like you see in a typical Hollywood movie where, you know, that guy's like a sexual assaulter, you know, that guy's a rapist or whatever. This just looks like a normal dude.
Just a guy in the woods.
Just a logger, just a dude.
Wearing his high-vis vest, you know, he's just trying to earn a living.
Yeah, and it just kind of speaks to me anyway that like the human race is fucking confounding.
Yeah, it is.
Because like you imagine, like Jason, you imagine you're an alien, okay? I want you to imagine you're an alien. Mm. And you come here.
Hello.
And you're trying to form this sort of overall consensus of the human race. How the fuck do you do that?
Fair. But we have to remember that in this movie, her job is not, she's not in Starfleet. You know, she's not observing the human race to learn data. She's but there halfway, to harvest them.
But halfway through, she tries
to... Yeah, she starts to learn a little
she
more.
She wants to fit in.
Yeah.
That's what I'm saying. Like, you want to fit in with the human race. How the fuck do you contend, like, something like this with something like this and something like this and something like this? Like, there's just so many fucking possible...
But that's the thing. We don't know what her headspace is. We don't know what kind of people her race of aliens are. We don't know if they may Perhaps they have as wide a variety of people as we do, or perhaps they're a much more monolithic kind of culture. We don't know. But for whatever reason, yeah, this would, I imagine, freak her out a little bit.
Well, I'd say they were specifically one way that is not like us, because she's confounded by everything that happens.
Well, yeah, and confounded by it because it's not a rape in the same way that a human would take it, because a human would be a traumatic, tragic event. But for her, she doesn't even know what's going on. No. I just have to assume.
It's like she's kind of like a scared animal.
Yeah.
Because this rape scene, it's not necessarily explicit. It's not explicit at all, actually. There's not really.
He basically starts tearing off her clothes.
It's messy. It's not shot like stylistically in any kind of way. It's kind of just happens.
It's just happening and kind of brutal.
And she gets away, and of course, this is the pivotal moment.
She gets away, but she gets away because he is tearing off her clothes, and when he tears off her clothes, he grabs her back, and he ends up tearing off a strip of her skin and revealing the black skin underneath.
You see the alien exoskeleton underneath.
Well, if you want to call it that. It could be skin.
Exoskeleton.
It didn't look like an exoskeleton to me.
The exoskeleton.
Because unlike in the book, these aren't canids, and they aren't like arthropods or...
Arthur? Like the aardvark?
Yeah.
Oh.
And I said, hey!
What a wonderful kind of day! It's a day to lurk and play and get original point of view.
A teacher gets married to a man and everyone gets mad.
It's funny. The teacher gets married, everybody gets mad. It's 2019. You remember in like the 90s when Jerry Falwell got mad because Tinky Winky was purple and had a triangle on his head and carried a fucking purse? It never ends. PBS is so edgy.
Goddamn you, Arthur.
Arthur. I watched a lot of Arthur. I had cousins that I babysat growing up.
It was weird that Russell Brand played him in the film adaptation.
Hello, I'm Arthur.
Yeah.
I'm an enfant.
But yeah, so at this point, she we see her her actual form.
Yeah.
And I mean, I think this is such a cool moment is when she takes off the human form. She's literally staring at her human form.
She is staring at the skin what she was under.
Yeah. And then the logger.
This is the most fucked up, unexpected part of the film. The logger fucking comes back, Brendan, and what does he do?
He sets her on fire.
He dumps gasoline onto her and then sets her on fire. Now, that says a lot about this logger, because one has to wonder how many other women that he's burned in the woods after he raped them, that he would do that to this woman, especially as he didn't even get to rape her. He just saw the black skin and thought, well, this is fucked up. Let's kill it.
Well, and I wrote down, we destroy what we don't understand.
Yeah.
I think that's a theme in this movie.
That's a great insight in humanity. It's true. We destroy what we don't understand. Yeah. So much of human history is based on that tragic principle.
And she dies with such a whimper. There's no flourish at the end. There's no big epic moment where
one
she's
wonders
kind of,
how much pain she's even this in is, at that
this,
point.
Exactly. We don't know how she processes pain. This is not a Wicker Man situation. No. We have the main character screaming out in horror as, they're being burned alive. Both movies end with people being burned alive. Yeah. Think about it, Jason. Connections.
Is Nicolas Cage somewhere in the background?
I think I'm talking about the 70s one.
Oh, okay.
but yeah, so it's really interesting kind of how that all comes to a head. And I mean, you got the ending with the bikers at the top of a mountain. We don't know if he knows, we don't know if he cares, he just kind of looks out, and that's kind of how it ends.
Yeah.
This movie says a lot about
I like the end of this movie, the way it looks with the snow and everything. She kind of she walks out burning into the snow and then collapses.
She just kind of collapses.
And then the other thing that we haven't talked about as much, but what has been going on is that the biker has kind of been following her around and cleaning up her mess. Because after the deformed guy, the guy with the deformed face is released, we see him wandering off into
through the fields.
And he's naked. He's no clothes. He's fucking naked. So he's just wandering off into the fields. And then later we see the biker coming along. He goes to a house, this random house, and he fucking walks up and he smashes the window out of the car and pops the trunk, and then walks into the backyard, and we see that guy in that backyard. Yeah. And he just grabs him or something, I don't know, I think it cuts away, and then we see him haul him out and dump him in the trunk, close the trunk and drive away, and an old lady from her window sees it happen. And so
that's interesting, because the whole thing is about destroying evidence, but now
there's a witness. Yeah, there's a witness.
And we don't really come back to that.
No.
So I wonder, what that's
sequel.
Supposed to be.
It's a courtroom drama. It's about that biker guy being put on trial.
Yeah.
For the murder of this guy, Ray Pearson.
Keep going. Cast it. Who's the judge?
Maya Angelou.
Okay.
Oh, wait, no, she's dead. Maya Rudolph.
Okay. Who's the prosecution?
Taryn Killam.
Okay. All right. It's a Saturday Night Live sketch.
Yep.
it's not a movie anymore.
And then we're going to have special celebrity guest star, Khloe Kardashian.
Okay. She's playing...
The defense.
Okay, so she's the biker?
She's defending the biker, yeah.
Oh, she's defending the biker. Okay, I got
No, no, we get the guy from the movie. We get that motorcyclist.
Okay.
Yeah, he just silently stands there
the whole movie. So who's hosting this particular episode of Saturday Night Live?
That would be a musical guest.
Wait, the musical guest is the host?
Yeah, okay. Moby.
So Moby is the host and the musical guest. Yes. And who is Moby playing in this sketch?
Moby is the bailiff.
Okay. All right, well, there you go. Lauren Michaels, it's your move.
It's your move, Lauren. Oh, we have so much fun on this show.
Oh God. Well, Jason, is there anything else you want to talk
about? Yes.
I don't want to jump the gun here because I know there's lots of stuff in this movie. Oh, I did write down. Can I just say one thing?
Oh, I have to say, Sandstorm. They go to a club, and Sandstorm by Darude is playing.
By the way, that club scene is real.
Yeah, it's a real club. It's
real club, real music, real people.
So they were running around with cameras in the club.
Spy cams.
Wow.
Yeah.
It looked real.
No, I wanted to say that Scarlett Johansson's reaction, by the way, when she's with that guy who they try to have sex or whatever, when he's showing her like British comedy.
Yeah, they're watching Tommy Davidson.
Her reaction to that, though, is I feel like it's a lot of Americans trying to watch British comedy.
Yeah, exactly. What is this even about? I mean, and folks, the joke is, I mean, with Tommy Davidson is he's a bad magician. That's kind of his whole bit, is that he's doing bad magician tricks. And if you go on YouTube, you can see Tommy Davidson die because he famously was on stage doing a bit and he collapsed and died and everybody thought it was part of the bit and then it cuts away to commercial. So if you want to watch a man die, check out youtube.com.
It's our sponsor. It's dark. It's real dark. It's real scary.
Yeah.
But yeah, no, her reaction, like her kind of nonplussed reaction is like, yeah, it's most Americans watching British humor. So is there anything else you wanted to kind of throw down?
Like overall?
Yeah.
So this movie and the tone of it reminds me of a couple things. Specifically, this movie is like a David Lynch movie, but without like a whole lot of defined characters. Because the thing about David Lynch movies is that they're weird, but they have like these like weird characters in them. And in this movie, the only characters we see are Scarlett Johansson and the little glimpses of the fellas that she picks up. So it doesn't have those weird characters. But the kind of the weirdness of it all, the tone of it all, the use of sound design is so strong. And again, it's very David Lynchian in that way. I was kind of then thinking in the sci-fi end of things, it reminded me somewhat of, and bear with me here, and I'll explain why. It reminded me somewhat of Dune from 1984, David Lynch's Dune.
I don't remember Sting being in this movie.
Yeah, I wish. That would have made it so much better. I mean, because Sting enhances anything, especially if he's wearing a codpiece.
Right. You're talking about Steve Borden, right?
Yeah, that guy. Just call me Sting. No, it's Gordon. Oh, you mean the other Sting.
Steve Borden the wrestler. Come on, dude.
I gotcha. Yeah,
stay with me. Know
that. But it reminds me of Dune in the sense that it is almost an interpretive take on the source material.
Okay.
Where, now, Dune is much more explicit in the sense that there's much more detail from the source material than I would say there is in this movie. But it is similar where... if you're not familiar with the source material, as I wasn't until about 5 minutes after the movie and I went and read the summary of the book, if you're not familiar with the source material, the movie is a little weird. And like Dune, especially Dune is a little, if you don't know Dune is like, why is everybody whispering? What the fuck is going on? Why is it raining? And why are people using sound guns?
My favorite computer game. You don't know Dune.
The great Dune trivia series. It covers all the books, even God Emperor.
Yeah.
But yeah, it reminds me of that in the sense that it's kind of a one director's interpretive take on a piece of science fiction that is not necessarily how you would expect it to be on screen.
Mm-hmm.
Dune is closer to that, but this is, again, very much in the same genre. And it's cool. And it's one of those things that I would kind of be interested sometime to see another author's take on this story. Like with Dune, we are expected to get a Denis Arcand. Is that the guy? The guy that directed Blade Runner?
Denis Villeneuve.
Denis Villeneuve. That's the guy. Denis Villeneuve is going to direct a new Dune movie. Yeah, it's fucking great. Cool.
I'm so excited.
I'm excited to see how that because I love the book. Dune is probably my favorite novel of all time.
I feel
time.
Like he's going to do it more for people who maybe are not so familiar with it too.
Well, that's it, and that's going to be interesting too to see how they go about, because it's such a dense, complex story, and I'm interested to see where they go. And I would be interested in the future. You know, it doesn't have to be anytime soon, but maybe 20 years down the road to see somebody take another crack at this story. Mm-hmm. Maybe do it more conventionally, like closer to the book, and do a big budget version, or maybe just take a different approach to it. It would be really cool. I mean, like I say, for me, Dune, I've got the 84 version, I've got the TV miniseries version, I've got the books themselves, and now I'm going to have a new version. So it's really cool to see those different interpretations of the same source material. So any other thoughts on your part?
Not really, before we kind of get into it a little bit further with the critique of the film. I think it's really interesting too that for me it almost kind of feels like this was made by a female filmmaker.
Yeah.
Because there's not a lot of that they call it the male gaze.
Mm.
And there's not a lot of that when we see like the nudity and the sexual stuff. Like it's not focused a lot on the man. It's not.
No, the only gazes in this movie are coming from the men she picks up, and they are quickly disabused of the notion that they are going to get laid.
And it kind of flips the script on the whole thing, where like, you know, a guy will go around picking up women, and obviously it's very terrifying.
Yeah.
But if a girl does it, you know, a lot of men are pretty willing to get into the van.
Clearly, a lot of them do in this movie. Some of them get where they're going if they have family.
But let's talk a little bit about this is. It doesn't do well at the box office. But I mean, that's to be expected. The budget of this movie is $13.3 million.
Yeah.
Box office around 7.2. So it doesn't really do too well.
Gotta make it up in DVD sales.
Doesn't go to the Oscars at all.
Unfortunate.
Which is unfortunate, because like the cinematography, the sound design alone, the sound editing, the sound mixing, especially technical awards.
You're telling me there was like five better movies in 2013 that had better sound editing than this movie?
Come on. I mean, it's...
Transformers can't win every Oscars.
Thank God that didn't happen. But at the BAFTAs, it actually does get nominated for Best Original Film and Best Film Music. Doesn't win, but it gets nominated.
Nice.
This movie was named the best film of 2014 by 20 critics and publications. In 2015, The Guardian named it one of the top 50 films of the decade so far.
Yeah.
Received multiple accolades, including the London Film Critics Circle Award for British Film of the Year and a European Film Award for Best Soundtrack. In 2016, it was ranked number one in the BBC's 100 Greatest Films of the 21st Century.
Wow, number one!
Maybe we should do something about that.
Maybe. Shit.
Number 61, sorry, not number one.
Oh, okay, yeah. Jesus. I mean, it's a good movie, but...
Which is an international poll of 177 critics. In France, the prestigious Cahiers du Cinéma, like the place under the skin on the third place of their 2014 top 10 chart. So this movie... gets accolades across the board. Audiences are very divided on this movie, obviously.
Yeah.
This is not a mainstream... It's the least mainstream film I've ever seen.
Yeah, I would say. And this is a movie that I don't think there'll be any in between. You'll either like it or you won't.
This is a movie I wouldn't casually recommend to someone.
No.
So I will say this. Since we are kind of coming up to the end here. If you are someone who likes a slow, deliberate pace... a kind of an interesting story that doesn't spell anything out for you, or doesn't spell a lot out for you, and you like this sort of beautiful cinematography, sound design elements of film, you enjoy the actual, like, you know, filmmaking stuff, you're not just like going for a cheap thrill, do not watch this as a regular horror movie. But if you're into that kind of stuff, I would say you will probably really like this movie. And I really like this movie.
Yeah, I liked it a lot too. And I wouldn't go so far as to call this movie a tone poem, but I would say it's definitely heading in that direction, where so much of it is kind of the feel and the look. It's not about like this intricate plot or anything, because we barely hear any dialogue. It's just about kind of showing you this happen. And it's really fascinating for that reason.
Yeah. And like Jason said, it's... the plot is not overly important. The plot, I mean, I would say that there are elements of the plot that definitely help with the story and help with your kind of interpretation of the film. And there's many different interpretations you can take. This is also one of A24's first movies. Mm-hmm. They're one of their early, like, I guess, horror movies. So if you like this one, Jason, you'll probably enjoy many of their movies. The Witch is very good.
Yes, I'm excited to see The Lighthouse.
The Lighthouse is fantastic.
Yeah, I've heard.
Hereditary is great. Midsommar is awesome. So it's a great collection of amazing, like, just auteur
yeah.
style horror movies, yeah. not just like, you know, boo jump scares or whatnot.
This is not; these are not movies made for Saturday matinee popcorn fests with the kids. No. Leave them at home, folks. Leave your kids at home.
Don't have a party and watch Under the Skin.
Oh, let's all get drunk and watch Under the Skin.
So I'm gonna say this right now. I think if they're like a future list, I honestly think this deserves a spot because it's unique enough to kind of have a placement on the list. And if we're gonna have five fucking David Lean movies on, yeah. we can have two Jonathan Glazer movies
damn
on. Damn it.
Straight. Sexy Beast, bitches.
Yeah, Sexy Beast and this movie. I would vote for both of them to be on the list.
Could we, I mean, I said it earlier where we could have a crossover. What if we had like a Jonathan Glazerverse movie where yeah. we brought in, you know, Under the Skin and Sexy Beast and right. even Birth, which we haven't watched yet.
Where Ben Kingsley turns out to be the child?
That's right. He's like, oh, I'm fucking hero, man. Fuck you.
I just pretended to be a child so I could fuck Nicole Kidman.
Yeah.
I mean, wouldn't we all?
That's, I mean, yeah. But that's, you know what? Let's not talk about this.
I mean,
this
she was in Days of Thunder.
She, oh man. You look like a monkey fucking a football out there.
Was that Days of Thunder?
Yeah, that's Randy Quaid in Days of Thunder. We look like a monkey fucking a football out there. And then, you know, that's Robin, son. Robin Rison.
Well, I gotta say, anyway, this movie, phenomenal.
This movie is phenomenal. Days of Thunder, also phenomenal. For different reasons. You can't go wrong with either.
Yeah, they're both the same movie. But Jason, now that we've talked about Under the Skin, we are done our little mini-series on...
Brit Picks!
Brit Picks. Movies that are not on this list, but yeah. maybe should be.
And we may come back to it at some point.
Oh yeah, I think we will. Spoiler alert.
Maybe we can finally watch Holy Grail.
Maybe.
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 Maybe we'll watch Meaning of Life. Maybe. We'll really go down the hole.
Maybe we'll watch Life of Brian.
We will watch Life of Brian. Day,
yeah. So now that we've wrapped that up, we're going to go back to the list.
We have one more movie, don't we?
We have two more.
Two more.
Two more, and then we're going to have our ranking show.
All right.
So, Jason.
Is it my turn?
It is.
Hooray! Were we doing Adventure Brothers
Your
thing?
Turn.
Oh, okay.
Nobody knows what you're doing.
I don't know.
No, we're
they
doing
can't
the,
see us.
We're doing the thing from Steel where Shaq and Annabeth Gish finger each other.
Oh, right. That, I don't remember that part of Steel. Of course, I didn't see Steel.
They
so.
Just touch fingers to each other because the director said they couldn't have a kiss scene because they were an interracial couple. Anyway, let's not talk about Steel.
Yeah.
That makes me upset. Okay,
Jason. Drop the dice on the floor.
Way ahead of the game here. So what are we going to do now, Jason? And now that we're going back to the list, what are we doing?
We are going to roll two D10s to figure out what the next movie we will watch on the list. The D10s can give us any number between 1 and 100. We've watched a good chunk of them. And if we get one, we'll re-roll.
If we get one, we'll re-roll?
Yeah. If we get any movie, we will re-roll.
Just keep rolling.
We're just going to keep re-rolling for the next 6 to 10 hours.
There's a reason this episode is so long.
Yeah.
So what Jason is going to do here first, he's going to roll the 10s, D10s.
Which is green.
Where we are on the list. Yeah, thank you. It really helps.
And then we're going to roll the 1s, D10, which is red.
Yeah.
Christmas just happened, so this is a reminder of all the good times you had at Christmas 2019.
Of course.
All right, so the first we've got the 10s is a 50.
Okay.
I feel like we've done most of them.
We've done most of them, that is correct.
So we'll see what we get. We get 55.
55 is the English Patient. We are not doing that again!
No, never. God damn it. Fuck you, English Patient. All right, we'll try again here. We got 60.
60, okay.
And we got 69. Up top, my brother.
60. Well... couldn't be any more perfect that this would be 69, Jason.
Mm-hmm.
We're going back to the work of the bard,
ooh,
William Shakespeare. We're going to talk about 1948, Laurence Olivier's Hamlet.
Oh, fun. Yeah, well, we knew it was coming at some point.
Oh, boy.
Yeah, here we go.
Here we go. So, all right. The black and white, 1948, Laurence Olivier. Adaptation of Hamlet. But that means we can open the door to other versions we could check out now.
Yeah, exactly. So, maybe we could watch all 4 hours of Kenneth Branagh's version.
I mean, probably.
Yeah.
We should
do that together.
Okay. We'll watch it together?
Yeah, like we did with the fucking Dr. Zhivago remake.
So we're going to be in the same room for 6 hours.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay, so I guess that's what we're doing. So next week, ladies and gentlemen, we will talk about number 69
yeah, up top,
on the list. Hamlet. Ooh. Laurence Olivier.
To be or not to be, that is the question. Whether 'tis nobler in the mind to suffer the slings and arrows of outrageous fortune, or by opposing a sea of troubles end them and...
it keeps going from there.
This shit is piss. I believe
that's Kai Havoc and let's slip the dogs of war. Oh, wait, that's Star Trek 6. Sorry.
Boy, oh boy. So now that we've wrapped that up, you can find us on Facebook. Just search for Four Screen.
And Gundry.
You can also find us on Twitter at BFI underscore pod. You can also find Jason on Twitter
at Jason D. McLeod. That's MacLeod, where I occasionally will dip my toe into arguing with people on the internet and realize that it is a fruitless task and that it is not worth it.
And he also will seduce people into giant pools, so be careful.
Mm. Well, it's real warm. It's real nice. Have you ever been in a pool of Jell-O? You would love it.
Have I ever been in the pool of Jell-O?
Oh, Bill Cosby, you showed up. You're my favorite comedian, and I can't like you anymore.
I was given a day off from the cell life.
Ah, I see that. You should probably just go. I mean, we can't have you here.
I just wanted to say Happy Father's Day.
Look, sir, you can't smoke that cigar in here. You have to go. That's a really gross way to smoke a cigar.
Hey, you get out of here. I'm a real icon, not you.
I've never been so happy to see Jimmy Stewart.
I'm sorry, fellas. I was working security at the door, and I must have fallen asleep.
You kicked Bill Cosby out.
I fell asleep at the post. Mm. Can I read another poem?
All right. One more before we go, but we really have to end this, Jimmy.
Under the skin.
Uh-huh.
Like a nice smooth gin.
Mm.
Let me tell you about my dead dog. One time he ate a frog.
Okay.
You know, LA is covered in smog.
I mean, that's true, yeah.
Anyway, time to go sleep like a log.
The best poems have anyway in them.
By James Stewart.
Been lovely, thank you. You're a legend.
Hi, Bill, get out of here.
You've killed more Germans than any of my favorite movie stars. Thank you, Mr.
Thank
Stewart,
you,
for your
Jimmy.
Service.
Thank you, Jimmy.
Bye.
Well, there he goes. Well, it's a revolving door here, Jason.
It always is.
But anyway, until next week when we talk about Hamlet, good God.
This could be rough. But we've all seen Hamlet before, so we know what happens.
Don't spoil it for me.
I don't have to fucking do a plot summary.
Well, we don't do that anyway.
I know. But still, I'm glad I don't have to.
Jason, I just have to say to you.
Say it.
God save the queen.
God save the screen.
And for Screening Country, I am Brendan.
And I am Jason.
Adios.
Well, I saw the thing coming out of the sky. It had a one long horn and one big eye. I commenced to shaking and I said, ooh-wee. It looked like a purple people eater to me. It was a one-eyed, one-horned, flying purple people eater. A one-eyed, one-horned, flying purple people eater. Sure looked strange to me. Oh, well, he came down to earth and he lit in a tree. I said, Mr. Purple People Eater, don't eat me. I heard him say in a voice so gruff,
I wouldn't eat you,
cause
you're so tough.
It was a one-eyed, one-horned, flying purple people eater. One-eyed, one-horned, flying purple people eater. One-eyed, one-horned, flying purple people eater. Sure.
Hey everyone, it's Chris and Mike from The Recasting Couch, the podcast where we take our favorite movies and discuss what they would be like with new actors in all the lead roles. Hey Mike, tell them where they can find us on social media.
You can find our website at therecastingcouch.com or on Twitter at recastingpod. And of course, you can listen to us on iTunes, Stitcher, Android, or anywhere else you find your favorite podcasts.
Yeah, if there's a service that's not posting our pod, you let us know and we will rectify that immediately.
Damn right.
Thanks for listening, everybody.
The great visionary leader of India, Mahatma Gandhi, said, "It is health that is real wealth, and not pieces of gold and silver." Listen to the Healthy Grocer radio show on your favorite podcast platform. We know that health is our greatest wealth, and we will be discussing all aspects of natural healing. Explore everything from supplements, superfoods, and healthy lifestyle choices to help conquer stress and boost productivity. Top industry experts and natural health professionals join us for a deep dive into our healing journey. You can find the Healthy Grocer radio show on demand every day, wherever you listen to your favorite podcasts. And remember, health is your greatest wealth.